Welcome to Behind the Seams, a transparent look into the world of fashion. Hosted by
Anne Price,
Emily Burns,
and Michaela Albright.
In today's world, current events are often misunderstood for two reasons. One being that sometimes we don't even know how we ended up in the place that we are in. We haven't been told enough about our family history, or we haven't been educated enough on our country's history to discover how we got to our current position in society. Largely, the public is educated on a minor note regarding issues such as slavery, immigration, and industrialization. We often learn how major events such as these affected our own country and countries like ours, but the scope is limited. Simultaneous events that were happening globally are left out, possibly considered as minor details. However, these minor details may actually set the stage for our understanding. Going further, current events are also misunderstood due to personal or cultural bias. A lack of having lived in another person's shoes, to have grown up in a different family, climate, country, where there are different rules, privileges, and restrictions, where there may be a different religion, or where your personal position in society might be lessened, can stifle our connections with people and places. We only know the life we've lived and understand others' lives much to the extent that we've experienced events with them, sort of making them our own. In more affluent places in the world, privilege can often buy a fence or a large curtain to shield or limit any type of interference or disruption of that privilege. However, fencing in a flower garden amidst a drought will only work as long as you have your own sustainable supply of water. Covering a window with a bad view will only serve its purpose as long as you have extraordinary lighting inside that room. Eventually, we won't be able to avoid these outside issues as they become too expensive to ignore. Hence, our neglect by overconsumption of these resources will not serve to solve these problems, but only feed them. We will watch these outside problems become inside threats. To an extent, the drought is already spreading to our garden. Our lights are flickering. Our costs are rising. Out of Sight, Out of Mind seeks to educate consumers on the backstory of their $10 t-shirts. Certainly, if we don't know how we got here or where we are, how will we know which way to go next? Let's start with the history. To begin, we have African historian Dr. Michael Panzer to open the dialogue of global labor mechanisms with the introduction of the term third world country.
Its origins, interestingly enough, this is where the historian now comes out, are in the Cold War, okay? Because during the Cold War, the rhetoric was first world, which was the West, capital W, the second world, which was sort of the East and the Eastern Bloc nations of the communist states. And then after World War II, there's this real big push by, the world was splitting and becoming more bipolar in that way, that there were other countries that were getting their independence as a result of European imperialism, right? So as these countries, like India being a predominant example, Indonesia being another one later on down the road, certain areas around the world saw an opportunity to just pursue a third way that didn't involve allying itself with the Western world, the United States, or the Eastern world, which, of course, in both cases would have targeted these nations with nuclear missiles and the rhetoric of espionage and so forth, not just rhetoric, but actions. So in 1955, quite a few countries, some that were recognized by the UN, some that were not yet, met in Bandung, which is in Indonesia, to have a conference about creating a third path, a third way, if you will. Instrumental there were Gamal Abdel Nasser, who was the leader of Egypt at the time. These are just the short list of some of the big wigs who were there. You had Jawaharlal Nehru, who was also the premier of India at the time as well. And quite a few other world leaders also attended this conference. And just for contextual purposes, this is 2 years before the first African country, right? The whole continent of Africa in general, the first African country to get independence was in 1957. So the African representation was really quite muted at that particular conference, minus Egypt and a few other countries that had representatives attending, but not actually not formally having a say. So the Third World Movement was part of a larger, what was called non-aligned movement. These countries are choosing not to side with one side or the other in the Cold War and pursued a different track. And what that track ultimately was one that sort of spoke out against the abuses of the capitalistic world. They were very aware of the geopolitical shift between France and England's domination of the world historically in the 19th and early 20th centuries, and how the world after World War II was shifting to a balance between the United States and the Soviet Union. And so in that chaotic periods in the beginning of this, sort of this new world order that was emerging, these countries were looking to find different directions forward that would not target them by their enemies or pretended enemies, but also trying to form, and stand up for themselves on their own two feet in a way that, you know, obviously dignified their agendas and dignified their countries as a whole. So the third world, it is a term that is not commonly used, so to describe it like how it would be used today, it has in the last 20 years fallen into disuse more and more, but what has substituted for that, right, because it's always the new buzzword, is the developing nations, right? You have developing nations, and developing toward what ends? At what point are they past tense that they're now developed, right? And the assumption with a word like developing is very problematic because, although the Cold War is over, developing sort of allows this open-ended question, right? And it's also a term that is invented by the West to describe countries where I work, for example, in Mozambique and East Africa, that are developing. Well, what are they developing to? What are they developing to become? We have this sort of vision in the Western world, I think, a lot of the time, that these are countries that kind of want to be like us or act like us or have all the same things we do. And as a side story, we see that with a lot of globalization right now, with iPhones and everything else going on, right? So that there is certainly that, but it's this perspective that we are going to move into this future. These countries are going to be like us at some point. But realistically, are they, right? And that's a question that this word developing sort of leaves open-ended and unanswered. And so developing is common. Sometimes you'll hear them as less developed countries. You'll hear that too, that, although they were called LDCs for a while. But really that rhetoric of third world today, when people apply that term, because it is still used, generally applies to countries that are very poor, typically not white, typically not Western. Their electricity might be spotty at best. Water issues are predominant. Governments are usually corrupt, right? They have this sort of rubric of this mental baggage that comes out of the Cold War. Because as the Cold War came to an end and the Second World sort of fizzled into, I'm not sure what to call it now, but it sort of fizzled into this age of globalization, the term Third World has stuck. And so it's become more associated with poverty, where during the Cold War it was actually a geopolitical term trying to delineate themselves between First and Second Worlds.
As previously stated, the Third World sought different ways of developing their economies as a result of the Cold War, often becoming masters of the land they lived on. People had different jobs that served the needs of their communities. Though, this practice was far from uncommon throughout the world. Nations throughout Europe and the Americas sought to modernize by mastering the land as well, but through a system that provided them an edge over the Third World. Just a century prior to the Cold War, the Americas were still practicing slavery as a means of developing the economies of the New World. To use the United States as an example, the U.S. started with the importation of African slaves to manually assist in creating towns and infrastructure for harvesting crops to be sold within the U.S. and exported into Europe. For hundreds of years, between the 15th and the 19th centuries, it cost tens of millions of lives to build the country we know today.
When slavery gave way to free labor, which of course people hear free labor, they say, well, isn't that slavery? It's free labor. But in that sense, it's obviously this is paid labor. People are choosing to work, or sometimes are in conditions where they don't have a choice, but are working. So slavery gives way to the foundations of modern capitalism to a certain extent. And slavery is that sort of hinge point where you see this, really sort of becoming the sort of global norm, certainly in the Americas in the 15th, 16th, and 17th centuries, right? So it starts to pick up pace, and then it provides the foundation for a very affluent class to emerge. What happens is that slavery makes less economic sense, right? So at first you say, well, sure, it does. It makes great economic sense. You have somebody who you're not paying, but you're getting all their labor, right? But if you think about it, you have to pay for that slave up front, right? Then you have to clothe them and feed them and house them. And typically speaking, although masters didn't spend much money doing that, this is why slaves are often ill-clad, they're very sickly, they live in these really shanty sort of homes or whatever. At the end of the day, they realize that if you are in a situation, right, where to a certain extent, like a sugar plantation, kind of functions like a factory, right? There's like a working shift, there's a certain routine to the labor, people are sort of housed, like if you think of an industrial town, they're sort of housed near the factory. In this case, slaves would be housed sort of near the fields, and there was a regiment, right? The sort of regiment of control that was all part of that. And so when slavery does come to an end for a lot of legal and moral reasons, one of the problems that, you know, the very wealthy capitalist classes had to figure out was, okay, so we ended for moral legal reasons. How do we trap their labor, though? Like, how do we give them freedom without freeing their ability to really choose what they want to do? And so slavery goes through a 2.0, right, where you have sharecropping becoming all the strategy that they use, where they're trapping people physically to a certain extent. On these, yes, they can move, and theoretically they can vote in the United States and pick our our country for a minute. But the reality was is that there were they didn't have that sort of freedom. They couldn't just simply pick up the next thing and become brain surgeons.
While the United States government instituted laws to keep African Americans bound to their former plantations, the government also searched for ways to modernize their cities, understanding the need to import additional labor in order to properly industrialize.
If you think about the middle class of the United States, you have all the immigrants coming in. We basically swear in all these people, right, in the 1890s through Ellis Island. And although it creates this sort of moral allure that America is this bastion of freedom and so forth, which is certainly partially true for most people, really a big reason for that was give us your poor, retired, and your weak, so we can put them into our factories, right? So then all the Irish and Italians, we're putting them into our factories, right? And Upton Sinclair's The Jungle is a good example of that, right? You have all these immigrants working in factories. So we basically imported our labor supply. We had former African slaves who are now African Americans, but most of them stayed as rural farmers. And the labor system, the laboring middle class that became the U.S. was imported, more or less, right? It was created.
The U.S. government sought to improve its economy by importing cheap labor to produce high yields of goods to be sold throughout the U.S. and to foreign entities. However, the U.S.'s neighbor, Mexico, sought the opposite way to economic mobility.
For certain countries, historically, it was a lot easier to do what's called import substitute, right? Where, so for example, a country like Mexico, which for them, it was a lot easier in the 1870s, 1880s, and 1890s, so going back a little 100 years ago, to simply import manufactured goods from the United States, including clothing, right, and other things, than to actually, build their own factories, pay Mexican workers to make those clothes there. That it was cheaper to do that. So who gets access to the clothes? Who gets access to all the latest technology in Mexico are the very affluent members of those societies.
As import substitution industrialization continued in Mexico, the gap between the rich and the poor increased as there were even less jobs for the lower classes to obtain. The rich, who were able to afford the luxuries coming in from the United States, benefited, and the poor continued to suffer. Though, a new idea began to flourish in Mexico through the influence of economic success within the United States. Positivism was embraced in the concept that industry and progress are inevitable, and good things for a country, so the government should do everything to promote industry and progress. This ideology still did not apply to the lower classes, as they could not contribute to the economic trade between the U.S. and Mexico. This new ideology again blamed the lower classes for their inability to afford goods. As unrest and resentment brewed amongst the Mexican lower classes, they began protesting against their government, revoking their participation in the mining and railroad industries. These protests greatly affected these industries, as the lower classes were the main source of labor. Simultaneously, in the 1890s, the United States started to grow a moral consciousness about child labor, as well as acceptable workday hours for an American employee. With the onset of labor unions and then the institution of laws by the U.S. government, it became cheaper for the U.S. to outsource their production to Mexico rather than to pay the U.S. workers a much higher wage. In turn, it became more expensive for Mexico to outsource their production to the United States, which marked the onset of increased industrialization in Mexico. Essentially, the United States brought their production to Mexico and further dominated the Mexican economy. Throughout the 20th century, as labor unions increased in size and strength, the United States' cheap labor source in hiring Black Americans and European immigrants became no longer cheap. Hence, it no longer made sense for the United States to manufacture, but to use import substitution themselves. Fast forward to the 1980s. Dr. Ann Davis, Associate Professor of Economics, Chair of Economics, Accounting, and Finance, discusses the preface to globalization.
It became easier to invest overseas in the 80s for some changes in the international economy. So it used to be you couldn't easily trade currencies, but then those restrictions were relaxed. And so now it's very easy to go overseas. So since the 1980s, those changes have taken place. So it's costlier here, easier to go there, and therefore I'm out of here.
As stated, the elimination of trade barriers allowed global access to foreign markets, further providing the opportunity for American manufacturers to move abroad or for American companies to subcontract their manufacturing abroad. In due time, an increasing amount of manufacturers relocated overseas, producing goods to be sold to Americans. Referring back to our previous segment on third world countries, the time had begun for American manufacturing to enter second and third world countries in search of cheaper labor. Again, we have Dr. Michael Panzer to set the stage.
There are countries that are clearly not in positions of power. They don't have the resource basis to sustain modern economies. Their political situation might be a bit more corrupt, and certainly, I mean, politics is corrupt, right? Let's face facts. But certainly, when we look at a country that's that poor around the world, the vulnerability they face as a result of not having that diversity in politics and economics. Right, so in a case like with the fashion industry, you know, part of the issue here is that it does deprive a lot of local incentive, right? That the allure of this is a big factory will come in, or sometimes a smaller one, but either way, they'll still hire X number of people. The governments, of course, there's usually deals that are worked out that the government gets some sort of a kickback for allowing this to happen. Sometimes those labor laws, right, get a little bit, like, neglected. And if the World Health Organization and other organizations, WTO, the World Trade Organization, are not monitoring these things, of which they have very limited ability to do in sovereign countries, then certainly there are abuses that take place, as you all know. And so, you know, I think that's sort of the question of sustainability. From the point of view of a lot of these governments, it makes sense that the allure of the jobs, getting people into a structured 9-to-5 or sometimes 24-hour-a-day cycle of working in these factories, as unfortunately does happen, that what you're actually doing is you're creating products sold in the West where the revenues come back that the elites benefit from. And so this is why when you go to third world or developing nations, you'll see such stark differences in terms of social class, right? Where you'll see the very affluent, extremely wealthy government types right around a Mercedes-Benzes and legions of them, where the vast majority of people still remain in poverty.
As American companies infiltrated into Eastern nations, the promise of a better standard of living and consistent payment drew people to the major cities, often requiring workers to leave their families behind several hundreds or thousands of miles away. Because it often required a large sum of money to travel from place to place, this was often goodbye for several years or even forever for many factory workers and their families. Though the promise of a better life filled their hopes and dreams, many of these hopes were quickly shattered upon setting foot on factory floors. Workers, which included men but were predominantly women and children, worked anywhere between 16 and 24 hours a day. They were often deprived of basic human needs, such as the right to eat or to go to the bathroom. The factories provided unsafe conditions in the form of faulty infrastructure, poor sanitation, toxic exposure to chemicals, the use of dangerous machinery, locked factory doors, among others. However, there was virtually no other alternative to factory life. The laborers worked day in and day out and received barely enough money to purchase food, nonetheless leave the factory in search of another, better life.
So that same sort of thing happens in other countries right now, where they're not slaves in the sense that, like, they're owned, like capital O, I could sell them to another factory owner if I want to, but they're wage slaves, right? So this is a big buzzword of the Industrial Revolution, right, where people that, you know, lived in sort of rural lifestyles, they may have been farmers historically and so forth, and that had real sort of sustainability knowledge of their own communities, have sort of, you know, followed the attractions of the globalized world. So in this case, you have these countries that they're not actively seeking to import people, but to a certain extent, the human trafficking issues is a big factor. Because if you find out to a certain extent that, you know, the political situation of whatever country is really bad, but that the situation in that country is less bad, people will sometimes put themselves in these very precarious situations to have themselves smuggled. Sometimes it's against their will, but oftentimes it's not, right? So there's not all culpability issue, but there's a lot of people who are out of desperation seeking a better life, in quotes, and that attraction is what mobilizes them, right? And that's part of the age of globalization, right? It's the movement of people.
The U.S.'s influx of manufacturing to the East, in countries stretching from China to Indonesia, not only brought urban jobs to many people, but also replaced many of the agricultural jobs that existed prior to America's intervention. Regarding the fashion industry, many plots were purchased for farmland to cultivate fibers such as cotton and others, depriving local farmers of the ability to compete with big business. As American production seized land and laborers, it also seized local businesses and autonomy for many citizens, giving them no choice but to work for these American corporations.
So one of the big issues of this sustainability question is how much this sort of age of globalization is sort of instituting the foundation for a middle class to really emerge. And that's something you don't really see in a lot of countries. There are a few exceptions to that where middle classes have sort of emerged lately. And in those countries where that's happened, it's been very, the success has been sort of mixed.
One example of a country where a middle class has emerged through an emphasis on cheap labor is China. At the time of the United States corporate entrance into the country, China was considered to be a part of the second world, though had a struggling economy and was still considered to be developing. Insert the imposition of American capitalism by way of the fashion industry, and things began to change drastically for the people of China. China's wrestle to a middle class can be explained further by Dr. Caroline Ryder, associate professor within the School of Management.
It's interesting. It's evolution. They used what they considered to be their competitive advantage, which was cheap labor and complete and utter disregard for the environment, so that the negative externalities of the environment were considered to be at a cost of zero, and the extraordinarily inexpensive labor then meant that you could manufacture all kinds of things and sell them at very low prices, and people would be delighted. So they did that for quite a while. But of course, as you do that, so a lot of money was pouring into China, and people in China were beginning to make money. And I guess it was maybe 2 years ago, might have been 2 years ago, that finally workers in general in China said, you know what, we need a bigger piece of this pie. We really do. We're going to go on strike for higher wages. Now, in a country like China, you don't get to go on strike unless the government lets you go on strike. So essentially what happened, politically speaking, was that the Central Committee of the Communist Party of China decided that politically, maybe not economically, but politically, the time had come when they were going to have to let people make more money, the workers make more money. So they have their own ways of signaling to the workers that, okay, it was going to be okay to strike. Because essentially what they were doing is they were striking the foreign corporations. So what was really happening was that the government of China was saying to foreign corporations, we're not going to give you such cheap labor. But you can go on polluting. We do have pollution rules, but we don't enforce them. So
what happened when China's labor wages increased? American companies ended their contracts with Chinese manufacturers and hopscotched their way to other countries with less regulation and therefore more leeway for low-wage exploitative labor. With little regulation on the extent of production, American fashion companies had full access not only to the laborers, but to the surrounding environment at large. Here, we have Peter Brickman, Senior Professional Lecturer of Fashion Merchandising on the Rise of Environmentalism in the U.S.
It's hard because we would love to make more things here, in factories here in the United States. But the environmental laws are very strong in a lot of states. One of the reasons why a lot of the apparel manufacturing mills closed in North Carolina was because of their strict environmental laws about polluting water. Disposing of dyes and things like that. It's very hard to do, and it's expensive. And we know the results of not doing it, the pollution in New Jersey and the Passaic River coming from all the factories dumping waste in there. It's horrible, you know, and the oceans, you know, the stuff. You've seen the pictures of what washes ashore out on the West Coast and on the East Coast. It's unbelievable. But remember, the people who are in this business are in it to make money. They're not in it to save the environment. So you've got the people who want to protect the environment, protect the sustainability rules and regulations, and then there are the people who want to earn a lot of money. And that is a very, very, it's a sad to say thing, but it's very powerful, very, very powerful.
The onset of environmental laws in the U.S. occurred from the 1960s to the 1980s, just before the dawn of globalization. the government was pressed to take action against oil spills, chemical pollution of waterways, as well as limiting air pollution and the use of harmful pesticides in agricultural production, establishing the National Environmental Policy Act, the Clean Air Act, revisions to the Federal Insecticide, Fungicide, and Rodenticide Act, among others, to protect communities, people, and the environment. As a result, the cost to produce within the U.S. increased, though environmental conditions of the country improved overall. Conveniently, Americans could have it all, the goods and the safety, as these new costs of production were externalized elsewhere, starting with China.
In the beginning, people had no idea, by the way. In the 1970s, people had no idea what was wrong. There was an article by Mark Sarsgaard in the Atlantic Monthly in 1978, I think it was. He had been to China, and he had been to a plant where they were just pouring this incredibly disgusting-smelling, oily, pink waste right into the river. And then downstream, he visited towns downstream, and one of the towns downstream said, Our gardens are dying. You know, we put this water on our gardens and then the plants die. And now it's so bad that we water our pigs and the pigs die. So we've concluded that we shouldn't drink it. So what they did in that village, they went to the local party representative, who in effect becomes the mayor of the village, and they said to him, okay, tomorrow morning, we're coming to escort you and your wife and your children down to the river, where you are going to go swimming, and then you're going to come out of the water, all of you, and have a nice big drink of water. And so, of course, when they got there the next morning, the family had fled, which is what they had expected. I mean, that's why they told them in advance, but they were making a point to the next level up of the Communist Party. So the regional Communist Party got an earful from the people who fled. It's like, you guys got to do something. And so that was the very beginning of environmental awareness that I know of in China. But it, of course, over the decades, 88, 98, 08, 35 years. So now people are pretty well aware of it. So you have this evolution, which we had too. Think of the London fog. You know, London fog was a photochemical smog. Killed people. Some of my ancestors ran a hat factory in Danbury. And they used mercury to felt the beaver fur. And the people just waded around in the mercury. Well, of course, that's where the saying comes, mad as a hatter. Because people got brain damage from their working conditions. And so that was in the early 20th century, 19th century. I guess it was the 19th century. And so basically this evolution takes place anywhere that this cycle happens. So the Chinese government has realized that they, politically, they can't afford to be the low-cost manufacturer anymore. They can't pollute their environment that much more. People literally can't breathe. They can't hold Olympics without shutting down half the power plants. You know, they understand that the people now are beginning to understand the correlation between pollution and ill health. They understand that there are enough people who have made a lot of money running around looking flashy so that other people are beginning to get a little bit resentful. And in China, don't push the populace too far. They don't know about democracy. They don't even care about democracy. They don't know about all the mechanisms that we have. What they do know is if you push them too far, they turn out in the streets and tear everything down. So that's kind of the balance that the government has to try to make stable. And so now, of course, production jobs are moving to Vietnam and Indonesia. Now, those ecologies, especially Vietnam, are pretty fragile because they're tropical. So I don't have a good feeling about that. You know, there's an awful lot of water that everybody depends on for everything, and they haven't really They don't have governmental mechanisms for controlling it. They don't have any citizen tradition of being on the lookout for it. So culturally, they are badly prepared for the onslaught of industrial production.
This process can be further summarized by Dr. Richard Feldman, Associate Professor of Environmental Science.
Why do we have our garments made overseas? They don't have the kind of regulation that is required in the United States. So you've eliminated that entire layer of regulation that has costs associated with it. So instead, we have those people in the less developed world being exposed to things that we would not allow our American workers to be exposed to.
It is evident that the use of exploitative labor and resources to feed economies and consumer wants is cyclical. It started with the incorporation of slavery, then moved to sharecropping and quote-unquote free labor. And once those mechanisms were not accepted in U.S. society, the same mechanisms, more or less, were taken elsewhere and replicated. It is difficult to comprehend that oppression, whether upon human beings or the environment, is what is relied upon to yield basic goods. People of the Western world are not often exposed to harmful working conditions, nonetheless outright neglect for the environment. This is because the Western world is made up of governments with the power to enact laws that will be enforced and regulated. For the past 40 years, this exploitation of human capital and resources within countries that do not have the governmental and economic stability of the Western world has largely contributed to climate change and civil rights violations. Simultaneously, miles, money, and widespread unawareness of these global issues have separated consumers of the Western world from the realities of the fashion world. Here is Richard Kramer, Senior Professional Lecturer of Fashion Design and Merchandising, followed by Kristen Baer, Assistant Professor of History and Co-Director of the Women's Studies Program, on the effects of outsourcing.
Before this multinational idea started, people would be like, let's say, in a small mill town in New England during the 18th century and the beginning of the 19th century. Everybody in the community was affected by whatever went on in that factory. But today, with multinational companies, what happens is directors, a board of directors, can regulate and control a business 10,000 miles away, and they don't need to be there. So that leaves us open to, let's say, if we produce in Bangladesh, they have no concern. All their concern is the bottom line. They don't consider what happens to the factory worker, what happens to the environment in which the factory worker lives, how the factory worker feeds his family. They have no concern about that. That is not a very democratic way to go, and the fashion industry is certainly not a democratic field.
This is what the so-called beauty of outsourcing, right, is that it's far away from you, and then you are further alienated from that labor, right? So we're alienated right now. If we look at the tags in our shirts and can't pronounce the name of the country where our clothing is, you know, produced, and we don't know where it is, but you're going to be, you know, further so if you don't and know you are not in touch with the conditions of people's labor or what goes around socially or environmentally, so...
Furthermore, here is Dr. Ryder on the resulting social impact of outsourcing.
How much of your economic activity you allow to be controlled by large market players, and how much of your economic activity you insist has to be contained within a playpen? Because if you let too much of your overall economic activity be controlled by large entities, whether they're state entities or whether they're private entities, you will tend to find that they mistreat their workers. They just do. So, and that appears to be true in almost any kind of economy. So, and once that happens, then everybody else feels justified in doing the same because they have to keep their costs down. So basically, it's a question of, is there the political will to create structures which are small enough so that the people who run them feel uncomfortable about doing that to the people who work for them? It's kind of like those experiments, you know, where if you couldn't, they did these psychology experiments. Remember the Ghostbusters? You know, are you willing to shock your... Well, they did. What they found was, if you couldn't see the people you were shocking, people just shocked them right away. They just go right ahead and do it, because they were going to get rewarded for doing it. But if you had to be face-to-face, that was a little different. And so size of organization has similar impact.
Dr. Ann Davis uses the company Levi's to further exemplify this concept.
Levi's, for example, uses low-wage labor in other countries, and that means that some people barely hanging on to their jobs and don't have enough political power to maintain environmental standards where the factory is sometimes, right? So I think, you know, they're part of a global supply chain of production, which makes use of cheap labor. They have to because other people are.
If the majority of companies are using cheap labor and exploiting resources because it's the only way to compete with the other market players, how is anything going to change? Might it be that we have to change the way we measure financial success or economic growth? Here is a portion of a discussion we had with Dr. Ann Davis regarding the benefits of environmental economics.
Okay, so environmental economics itself pays attention to what mainstream economics considers externalities. And to say externalities, it seems to suggest peripheral or not really very important. And so then it says, well, what are those externalities and how important are they? In mainstream environmental economics uses prices and taxes to try to correct the market failure and bring environmental awareness back in. I personally, however, try to go further and say, well, we really should look beyond the market. We should understand how the ecology works because it's really the bigger picture, and the market fits into that. And maybe we should subordinate the market to the ecology instead of the other way around. And so that's a hard message, because then how do you make decisions? And who's in charge? Is it the scientists as opposed to the economists? And so it's still an open question, and the field is still evolving. Nitrogen is one thing I mentioned earlier. So nitrogen fertilizer, artificially made, and mechanical, say, tractors using fossil fuels lead to larger yields in the short run. And so it seems cheap, and we all have lots of food as a result, right? More than we...
And cotton.
And cotton, too. But if you say the environment comes first, not just productivity this year, then you would say, hey, wait a minute, using all this fertilizer harms the environment and destroys the soil. And so same thing with tractors and mechanical techniques. And so we really want to go to small mixed-use farming where the output of one sector, like manure, is the input to the other sector, like fields that need to be fertilized or crop rotation. So those kinds of things or lower productivity take longer, but in the long run, they're more sustainable. But in economics, anything past a few months in the future isn't worth as much. You have to discount the future. And therefore, anything that's long-term is just not important. And so it's almost like you have to throw away the usual way economists value the future and say, no, the formula's wrong because we don't get the right answer. And so we have to use a different way of calculating the future value of something.
Definitely.
So is that the economic impact of moving towards a more sustainable business model? Like, you would really have to just kind of like reimagine, reboot the whole economic perspective on the type of gains you'd be receiving?
I think so. So, for example, water and sewer is like, oh, the stuff that you know, the engineers have to worry about, and what I really care about is the building and the, you know, how the house looks, right, and how it adds to my status, right? But in fact, water and sewer is how we take water, how we use it, how we pollute it on the other end. And it's really one of the most important things we do. So waste, like human waste disposal, becomes a very important issue, not just washing things down the drain or industrial waste, but human waste. And so things that we just relegate to some periphery, not really worth paying any attention to, become central, like how do we use our water, how do we purify it, should we charge for it, who should be managing water, and land use, who should be cutting down the trees, if anybody. I want a tree tax, right? And so that would slow down development, and that would be a horror to any business person or any finance person. They'd say you're going to destroy the economy, and I would say, excuse me, we're destroying the earth. What about tomorrow? And they say, forget tomorrow. I mean, that's the way the models go. And so it would really reorient and it would redesign a lot of the things we do. The way we build, the way we produce, the way we farm is, you know, needs to be redesigned. It's not that we have to eliminate it. We need to do it with the environmental impact in mind. And that means we would do it very differently and it would cost more. So you already see how, like, traumatic this would be.
Yeah. In a way, it's kind of like sustainable economics. You're not using a resource that's finite. And that's really, like, key to being successful in the long run. And I think in the short term, companies are just concerned with their quarterly profits. And so that initial investment is hard for them. But I think that the only way to move forward, and I think in sustainable fashion, we can still have funness. We can still have newness, as long as that comes with innovation.
So the transition, what I'm talking about is a redesign. And by the way, a good person on this is William McDonough, who's talked about the next industrial revolution and has several other books too. And he has this phrase, waste equals food. In other words, there is no such thing as waste. And if you use it right, it helps produce food the next period. And so instead of waste, you reuse within the production process. And I don't know if they've gone so far as to say old products or waste from the production process, like dyes or whatever, are also recycled or cleaned or something. Yeah, so whatever the production process is, there's nothing going out except it's reused.
What Dr. Davis is referring to is closed-loop production, further exemplified by Dr. Ryder.
Gunther Pauli, have you ever heard of Gunther Pauli? P-A-U-L-I? He ran something called Z-E-R-I. And he had basically two ideas. Idea number one, group your production facilities so that the waste of each production facility can be mostly recycled right there to be used as an input in the next facility. So create clusters of facilities. They may not be in the same industry, but if this one can use that one's waste products, you will have a whole lot less waste at the end of the process. So that's one idea, which he actually was able to implement in some South American countries. And the other idea that he had was, which I thought was interesting given the historical focus, he said, look at the way our manufacturing and industrial procedures have evolved. They've evolved incrementally as science has evolved. But because we've invested so heavily in the processes and the infrastructure that developed starting in the 1700s, we've created tied up capital, which is invested in very bad processes. So, if you're going to go into a new country, you should go with new science.
That being said, what is stopping companies from moving towards the long run? It seems that it could be an even more profitable decision.
Well, but only in the future.
Mm-hmm.
And so you would think it would be obvious and everybody should do it, but it's costly to make the transition. It's costly to think about the redesign. And it would take money and time to make the transition. And we're in a very time-driven, short-term, as you're saying, driven economy. And so if one company says, I'm going to do better, they might get outcompeted in the short run, as long as that isn't valued in the market. They're going to get outcompeted and they're going to go out of business. So there's this push that, you know, you can't without some kind of government rules, and in this case, international government rules. A single company would just go bankrupt. And so how strict should the standards be now, kind of thing?
Yeah.
And so are you going to say, well, it's better than it was, so that's okay, I'll buy it? Or do you say, no, it has to be? And here again, I think it's where we need specific standards. Like pollution, the smoke going out the chimney, you know, can't have more than CO2, you know, particles per million, right? I think we need standards, and those need to be set environmentally with the ecology in mind. Here's where the scientists come back in. And so it's not the firm that sets the standards, it's the ecology and the global picture and how the whole, all these biogeochemical cycles interact with each other, right? The water and the nitrogen and the carbon. You know, so I think we need to set the standards based on science and just say, this is the standard. And if you don't meet it, well, you have to have some kind of tax or fee.
Now today, these big fashion companies, they have a lot of money. They have a lot of money, and they can contribute it to political campaigns, and kind of, I mean, influence the government a little bit in that way because they are so powerful with their profits. Do you think that there's still a way to push for government change on a mass level, even with, you know, Wall Street and corporations having a lot of power over the government in that way?
Yeah, campaign finance is really devious, and it's unfortunate, and it's now worse than it used to be after 2010, the Supreme Court case. So, yes, lobbying takes place, and it undermines our capacity to make consistent rules for all companies. They're going to say, no, our industry is exceptional, we need this, because we give jobs, or some such, right? And so I think it's hard, and campaign finance needs to be limited, and that means the Supreme Court vacancy is very important. So, yes, those are important features. You know, and the existing model gives a lot of profits to existing companies, especially successful branded companies. That gives them a lot of power to keep their model. But, you know, that's another reason why the transition is so hard, is they have a lot of entrenched power. And so making the transition is hard, costly. Yeah, so if we had standards and everybody had them, then you wouldn't lose your competitive niche by doing green. You would all be doing it, and therefore it would be a new floor, right? It's kind of like a minimum wage. And, oh, by the way, the work week used to be 7 days, 12 hours, and then they said, no, 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 we can't have it any shorter because we'll lose money. Well, yeah, but then they designed other ways of manufacturing. So now we have a 5-day, 40-hour week, and we're still able to stay in business. So it's costly. It will take time and energy to make a transition. But if everybody has to do it, then we could have a new model. Our clothes will be more expensive, but we might have jobs.
And in a way, too, when we look at fast fashion and, like, this lack of quality, you have to buy something new. Like, let's take a pair of jeans or a t-shirt. You have to buy a new cheap one every couple months, whereas if you spent that big initial investment, you have one that lasts you a long time. And this kind of goes along with this economic model that would, you know, probably be a lot better because you're not always having to do little things. It's like a big change.
So clothes would be more expensive, but then you wouldn't buy as many.
Exactly.
You wouldn't need to buy as many. So it would rearrange the way we live. You wouldn't have the fashion of the moment. You'd have the fashion of the decade.
And
but can you live like that, right?
And maybe even, you know, what you were saying, you know, there might be more job creations. People, you know, things get more expensive. But people might get paid more to do those jobs. So maybe we will just have more money to accommodate things being more expensive.
Mm-hmm. It's kind of like a slow economy.
Yeah.
Right? And it'll be more expensive, but you might have more employment. Right? And you might buy things that are more valuable and that are worth keeping and reusing.
Do you think going forward a lot of production will move away from developing countries and kind of come back to, you know, the country of origin, either like in Europe or in America, because we see these types of corporations influencing each other?
If the company is not so concerned with having the latest, cheapest, and hopscotching around the world with subcontractors, then if they say, okay, this is a trend and people want value and quality, then they may be willing to invest in long-term employment in a single place, right? So that used to be the case, but it is no longer the case. So employment is becoming more contingent and less secure. And so I think if there were global standards, there wouldn't be the loss of from locating back in the United States. If everybody had to pay the same minimum wage, had the same right to organize and the same pay scale, then you could come back home and not lose profit compared to your competitors, right? Because right now, you get profit by going to the lowest cost place, as long as it's the lowest cost, and then when the wages rise there, you move, right? So you have a very mobile economy, which means you're not committing to your employees because you can't. You have to keep moving. Because the jobs are more insecure because the production is happening in supply chains in other countries. So the companies are not committing to full-time employment here. And so everybody's kind of making do. The so-called gig economy, where you take a short-term thing and then go on to the next one. I mean, that's possible, but it's not necessarily a very secure way to live.
As discussed, an efficient way in restructuring our business is through engaging in a closed-loop system. This benefits the environment, as there are no waste emissions as a result of production, the people handling production, as technology is used rather than manual labor to dispose of and process waste, and the pockets of business owners are strengthened, as a sustainable process of doing business is created, in addition to the fact that fewer raw materials will need to be purchased to feed production. However, let's say that this doesn't happen, that businesses do not transfer over to this process. What will happen? Here is Peter Brickman on that scope.
It seems as though there's a magnet towards production where it's cheapest.
Mm-hmm.
Eventually, they're going to run out of countries or economies that can produce at the cost that we're doing now.
You would think, right?
Yeah.
But here's the big but, and you're right, and I've thought about that too. Okay, how many poor countries are there in the world? However, there are like 234 countries in the world. Do you know how many countries there are in Africa? That's where production's going to move. It's going to move to Africa because there are millions, tens of millions of people there who are not able to earn a sustainable amount of money to live. And that's where production's going to move. So maybe, I mean, what? Maybe we're going to go to Antarctica, you know, and have penguins make stuff. I don't know.
The industry will really have to dissect itself as a whole and discover its place in the more advanced future of our world. Will it really cost less to skip from country to country, exploiting all of our people and natural resources? Or will it cost less to invest in research and development for a new way to operate, so that our industry exists in the future? We have Sonia Roy, Senior Professional Lecturer of Fashion Design and Merchandising, on one of the biggest issues facing the future of the fashion industry today.
The industry is still filled with people that will overlook a lot. I've been at, you know, meetings when I was in the fashion industry where we knew bad things were happening somewhere, and there was always somebody there telling us to look the other way. Or if you didn't look the other way, you were going to have to find another job. So that is full. It's full of that. It's full of that. And this is how things happen, right? Every time a child works in a factory, somebody knows that child is working in that factory. They're looking the other way. It's not like, oops, we accidentally hired a five-year-old. That's not going to happen, right? So somebody's looking the other way, and the industry is full of people that will look the other way.
One might be wondering, why is it legal for a U.S. corporation to abuse people and resources abroad? Or, if it isn't legal, why aren't these corporations prosecuted by the U.S. government? Here is Dr. Ryder on the complexities of the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act.
The Foreign Corrupt Practices Act says, if you have a company here and you either bribe a foreign official or allow one of your partners or suppliers to bribe a foreign official in order to get business, you here are guilty of a felony. Right? Now, you could do the same thing with working conditions or with materials or with waste disposal practices. You could say, your and the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act does make you responsible for your supply chain. So not only can you not bribe them, but your supply chain can't bribe them either. You could do the same in any field. The difficulty is when you're talking command and control mechanisms, which is what that is, we command you not to do X, and if you do it, we'll endeavor to control you by prosecuting you. So the difficulty with command and control mechanisms is that they're very expensive. If you think about it, you're going to have to go after sort of example companies. You're going to have to go after a company and make it a high-profile example of it to strike fear into the hearts of other corporations, because you're just not going to have the money. The taxpayers are not going to give you an unlimited budget to go after everybody. So the activist education aimed at reputation is faster and cheaper, but at the same time, they have to keep at it. It's got to keep going. So people like me have to continue to send donations to those activist organizations. In effect, we tax ourselves. Those of us who are interested in this sort of thing tax ourselves in order to have these organizations go out there and do it for us. We could ask the government to do it, but first you've got to get the political consensus that it should be done. And then you've got to get the budget every 2 years or every year or whatever it is to make sure that it gets done. There have been situations where consumer outcry in the United States about the sourcing that companies here, shoe companies, sportswear companies, the sourcing that they do in other places, people say, what? I'm wearing sportswear that was manufactured by children in a horrible concrete block building somewhere in inner China. Are you kidding me? And then then sentiment arises and people stop buying it, and the company that got it from there says, oh dear, 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 we guess we shouldn't do that. Sometimes if you can inform and ignite indignation in the public, they, at this end of the chain, force change at the other end of the chain.
So, how do consumers force this change? Where exactly do we begin? The first step, exemplified by Dr. Ryder and Dr. Davis, is to question.
We have recycling in Red Hook, and every week I religiously take my bottles, my plastic bottles, and my plastic thingies that the lettuce came in, the organic lettuce, mm-hmm. and I, clamshells, I guess, they're clear plastic clamshells, mm-hmm. and they all go in the bin, and then I say to myself, I wonder if it's really happening. You know, I wonder what happens after this. Do they really take it someplace, and does it really get made into something useful?
And then it's up to you to do the research. Are they just greenwashing, or are they really changing the model?
Dr. Ryder and Dr. Davis stress the importance of interrogating the model. Richard Kramer goes even deeper as to question yourself.
Do you want to work the rest of your life for somebody who doesn't give a about the environment and what happens to the planet, doesn't care what happens to other civilizations, in, oh, it's over there someplace? That's just a wrong attitude.
As an overall objective, it is important to keep our eyes open to the possibilities that could be affecting our futures as well as others.
I think that your average shopper looking around at, you know, a fast fashion retailer really, you know, doesn't look at the label and might not necessarily care what really is behind it. Because if it says made in Bangladesh, what does that really mean to them? They don't really know what the conditions are like there for workers or how their garment was produced. They're not given a story behind it, so, you know, why should they care?
Yeah, I agree with that. I feel like there's a lot that those tags are saying, like made in Bangladesh, how much of that garment was made in Bangladesh for it to be able to say that.
And you have this, like, it's almost propaganda, because when you look at the food industry, they have an illustration on your butter container that's this beautiful, you know, classic red farm. But in reality, like, there's really bad conditions, and it's factory farming, but they put the label on there that shows this was made in a nice little farm down the road from your house. And it's not exactly the same in fashion, but there is kind of this association with a brand name of goodness or niceness. But then in reality, there's this conflict. It's not really what the label is like leading up to, but we don't really know the story behind it.
Yeah, it's like going along with that, what I was just saying, like how much of the garment has to be made in Bangladesh. We don't even know where all this stuff was coming from. Like, there is no clear-cut red barn. You know, it's maybe a button was sewn on in Bangladesh and another part of it was sewn in Vietnam. The fibers came from a farm in China. Like, you don't know necessarily. Because, you know, we can have a cotton t-shirt and it will say it's 100% cotton, but I think really only about 80% of the fabric needs to be cotton for them to be able to say that.
Exactly. And even if you have something that's made in the USA, it could be, you know, the final touches, like you're saying. And a lot of corporations will do this to avoid, you know, tariffs or quotas. So you have you have an order of sweaters, 50,000 sweaters, right? But there's a minimum, and you can't get it in. You can't have them all manufactured in China. So what are you going to do? You're going to make them all in China. You're going to send half of them to Madagascar, get the label sewn on there, and then ship it to the U.S. So there's all this mystery, even if we do look at our tags. It's out of sight, out of mind.
The following excerpts are from a phone interview with Amy Hall, who is the Director of Social Consciousness at Eileen Fisher. In response to the question, what can the consumer do now to affect change?
When I think about an individual who shops with his or her values, I encourage people to consider what the full story is of that garment that they're buying. It's not just about what it's made of and where it's made. It's about all the hands that touched it along the way, who dyed the fabric, who cut the fabric, who sewed the fabric, who sewed the label in, and all the inputs along the way, the chemistry, the water, how was that fiber grown originally in the field somewhere? Where was it grown? Who cut the fiber and then transported it to the spinning mill where it was spun into yarn or thread? There were people along the way. There were materials and resources used along the way, and to really consider, if you buy that garment, how many times are you going to wear it, and will the amount of times you wear it pay for the impact that that garment has had on the planet and on its people?
In terms of a person's individual impact towards a more sustainable future, it is always best to be conscious and informed about current events that you may have some impact upon, large scale or small scale. In terms of your effort,
it's a good policy to say, just do the best you can.
Before listening to the next episode of Behind the Seams, print out a blank map of the world and try to label as many countries as you can. Often, this allows us to better gauge our actual world knowledge and understanding. You may be surprised to see how many countries you know, or how little. Next, watch the short documentary series Sweatshop, Deadly Fashion,
where three Norwegian students traveled to Cambodia to observe the working conditions of garment workers serving some of the largest fast fashion corporations in the world.
If you're interested in learning more, follow us on Instagram at Behind the Seams Podcast or visit our website at thefold.marist.edu/behindtheseams. For further questions, email us at behindtheseamspodcast@gmail.com. This episode of Behind the Seams was produced by Anne Price, Michaela Albright, and myself, Emily Burns. For this episode, we would like to thank our showcase contributors in order of appearance, Dr. Michael Panzer, Dr. Ann Davis, Dr. Caroline Ryder, Peter Berkman, Dr. Richard Fellman, Richard Kramer, Dr. Kristen Bayer, Sonia Roy, and Amy Hall. A special thank you to Wayne Price for the original song, Melissa Halverson for Capstone Advising, and the Marist College Fashion Department and Capstone Advising Committee.